We'll pick up last few sentences, what we did last time, and then continue further. He has been describing until now all the glorious things this life has done here. But then there is also a problem that she is not able to do what she wanted to do. On the contrary, something which was not expected in the scheme of things, that was appearing. And basically, what the poet is driving at is, he is preparing all the glorious paths of life, but there is a contradiction also here. There is joy, there is pain and suffering here. He is preparing us in a very systematic, organized manner to take to the next canto, the descent into night, canto 7, you see. And then the world of falsehood, evil, and that kind of a thing, you see. How life has undergone that kind of a change. That is the whole logical sequence in the scheme of the poem. A comrade of silence on her austere high, comrade of silence, the silence, the supreme, the absolute. It is the absolute who called the divine force out of his silence and made her do work. Aditi was sort of summoned by the Paratpara and she started doing her work. It is that silence between Satchidananda and the absolute where she is there stationed. Comrade of silence on her austere high. So she really belongs to that kind of a category. But then, accepted by her mighty loneliness, he stood with her on meditating peace. He is identifying himself completely with his life force, completely. And therefore, where she is standing, he is also standing. Where? He stood with her on meditating peace. Meditating what? Yes, how this has happened. And how the miracle is going to change, how there is going to be kind of a reverse effect of all the things. That is the kind of a thing he is going to meditate on the high peaks, on the peak of Matterhorn. You see, he is sitting there on the peak of Matterhorn and trying to wonder why it has happened. Where life and being are a sacrament, on that peak, life and being are a sacrament. In the Last Supper, you see, that is the sacrament of the Last Supper. Offered to the reality beyond reality, that is again the Paratpara, the Supreme, you see. He saw and saw her lose into infinity. Saw her lose into infinity. Her hooded eagles are significant messengers of thought to the navel. She is sending out of that meditation. She is sending her eagles to the unknowable, to the unknowable, the non-manifest. She wants to get the messages from him. She wants to get indication, hints from the unknowable. Yes, this is what is happening. What do I do? How I proceed further? She wants to get kind of messages from that. Saw her lose into infinity. Her hooded eagles are significant messengers of thought to the unknowable, all the way up to the unknowable, see, beyond Satchidananda, unknowable. Now, eagles of significance. Let me read something from what we have here in this marvelous book, Running to Savitri. When I start reading it, I really find it's quite encyclopedic. There are a lot of things here in this book. Lot of references are there. Okay, now about the eagles of significance. I will read something, some quotation from here. The German eagle, you are going to German. The German eagle is fluttering in the tempest. The German eagle is fluttering in the tempest. Refers to a vision in Swapna Samadhi. This is a passage from Sri Aurobindo Record of Yoga. This thing is from Record of Yoga. The German eagles are fluttering in the temple. Refers to a vision in Swapna Samadhi, dream trance. Swapna Samadhi, dream trance. two rocks high in heaven at an incredible height, showing prana jagat, prana jagat of life, you see, the world of life, prana, life, jagat, world, prana jagat, a narrow passage between these two. At outer mouth, an eagle attempts to advance into the open. From that place, the eagle advances into the open, but is met by a violent wind which prevents his progress and is struggling against it. The eagle wants to come out of it, from that opening, but is struggling, but is met by a violent wind which prevents his progress and is struggling against it. Now, this is the record of yoga. We don't know what it refers to actually. We have absolutely no clue of that thing. I was only wondering whether the German eagle, see, he says, German eagle is fluttering in the tempest. Fluttering in the tempest. I was only wondering whether it could mean the World War II. The eagle is fluttering in the tempest. Tempest standing for the turmoil and that kind of a thing here. But then, yeah, but then it is not that date. This record of yoga belongs to much, much earlier than that. Maybe around 1918, something like that. Before 1920, definitely.
1940.
20. Yeah, no, this particular one does not belong to that era. So I don't think this has anything connected with the World War II, unless it is a far fore vision of things to come. Far fore vision of things to come. You see, which is likely. The yogi is there, he sees not only today's time, he sees much ahead of time also. You see, it is possible that he is seeing all the temples building up and the eagle is trying to come, but cannot come out, you see. So it could be that also, you see. Because yogi sees beyond time also, all these things, you see. The German eagle is fluttering, he says specifically German eagle is fluttering in the temple, refers to a vision of Swapna Samadhi in trance meditation, dream trance, you see. Two rocks in high in heaven at an incredible height, showing prana jagata, the world of life. So, the tempest is connected with this life force, life movement, life loka itself, you see. That is what we are doing also in a way. A narrow passage between. At outer mouth, an eagle attempts to advance into the open. Eagle attempts to advance. He says, eagle is trying to bring a happy message, a glad message, something benedictive to mankind, but it is not able to advance, you see that. But is met by a violent wind which prevents its progress and is struggling against the tempest. Well, this is what we have got in the record of yoga. Then I got a note here. Eagles are significant. This phrase, eagles are significant. The eagle with his keen eyes symbolize perspicacity, clear sight, courage, strength, immortality. That is the character of the eagle. Perspicacity, courage, strength, immortality. But he is also considered king of the skies. Eagle is the king of the skies. And messengers are the highest gods. Eagles are the messengers of the highest god. With these attributes, attributed quality, the eagle becomes a symbol of power and strength in ancient Rome. Power and strength in ancient Rome because of this quality of eagle, you see. Mythologically, it has been connected by the Greeks with the god Zeus, by the Romans with Jupiter, by the Germanic tribes with Odin, by the Judeo-Christian scriptures with those who hope in God, and in Christian art with St. John the Evangelist. So this is the connection of the eagle in the Western civilization, you see. Now, in ties of Genesis, in that paragraph, the eagle's lofty flight and keen vision represent but another form of the same divine spirit. Another form of the divine spirit itself is what in Genesis, that is the symbolism of the eagle, you see. According to Swedenborg, flying eagle signifies the divine truth of the world as a knowledge and thence understanding. Divine truth, knowledge, understanding. These are the three grades of knowledge. Divine truth, knowledge, understanding. So, eagle flying signifies the divine truth. To the Egyptians, the eagle was the messenger to the gods and the sun, a symbol of eternal life. Eagle, the symbol of eternal life. To the Romans, the eagle was the carrier of Jupiter's thunderbolt. Eagle, the carrier of Jupiter's thunderbolt, and a sign of power, which was adopted as a symbol of the Roman emperors. That is, this eagle was and was carried before the empire's legions. Okay. To the Greeks, the eagle was the messenger to the Greek god Zeus. Obviously, that we know very well. And Zeus took the form of an eagle when he carried his young lover Ganymede to Mount Olympus. He took the form of an eagle and took him. There is a Catskill eagle. Catskill eagle. In some souls that can alike dive down into the blackest gorge. The eagle can dive down to the blackest gorge and soar out of them again and become invisible. Dive down, becomes invisible in the sunny spaces. And even if he forever flies within the gorge, that gorge is in mountains. So that even in his lowest swoop, the mountain eagle is still higher than the other birds upon the plain. That is the highest flight of the eagle, highest plane, even though they soar. That is from Herman Melville, Moby Dick. This passage you see, he is describing in Moby Dick this, the nature of the eagle. Now, he says here, the mountain eagle is still higher than the other birds. Higher than the other birds. In the Ramayana, there is a classification of birds. 7 types of birds. Sparrows, small little birds, parrots, etc. They will fly up to the side. Then there are other birds will fly at this side. There are other birds that will fly at this side. There are still higher birds which will fly at the highest height. And eagle height is the highest. Hawk, eagle, Garuda. They fly at the highest height, you see. Now, the episode occurs in the Ramayana. Sita has been abducted. And now, they have to search where she has gone and how to recover her back and all that thing, you see. So, in the course of the episodes, Rama meets Sugriva and Maruti Hanuman and all those people, you see. Now, Hanuman is in search of where the location of Sita is. Now, while they are going that thing, Jatayu, that is the eagle of Vishnu, he is the vehicle of Vishnu, Jatayu. According to Indian mythology, Jatayu, Garuda, as we call it, Garuda, he is the vehicle of Vishnu. And Jatayu fought with Ravana and wanted to save Sita from being taken away by him. But then Ravana cuts his feathers and he falls prey there, you see. Now, the brother of Jatayu, this eagle, is Sampati. So, this search party, when they arrived at a certain mountain height, they meet Sampati. Hanuman and all that, they meet Sampati, the brother of Jatayu, who is there. And there, Jatayu says, yes, you are looking for Sita, but from this mountain height, I can see at far distance, look in that forest, under that tree, she is sitting there. He spots that Sampati, spots the location where she is seated there, you see. Now he says that, look, we belong to that category of birds who fly at the highest level, at the highest height. And our vision extends far, far, far beyond normal sight, you see. So we have got that faculty, and therefore I can easily spot the presence of Sita in that. See, small little, I mean, see, imagine. So, what kind of resolution he has got for the eyes in a big landscape to find somebody seated there. There should be a remarkable resolution of photography also, you see, to locate like that. So he tells that, look, we belong to that category of birds. Seven, he describes now all the seven categories of birds. And then he says, hawks, garuda, eagles, they belong to that category, and they can see at farthest distance, mighty, hefty wings like that. So this is the eagles of significance. So this is the eagles of significance they got here. Her hooded eagle. So she is sending now her eagle. Eagle particularly, not other bird, because it can fly at the highest height and can reach in its sight the farthest distances also. Farthest distance, because these eagles had to go to the unknowable to carry her message. The message of life has to be carried to the unknowable. So the significance of eagle is very pertinent that we see. Why he has used the word eagle, you see. Her hooded eagle, so significant. Messengers of thought to the unknowable. Now, normally, we are familiar with the messengers who come from God and give us something. But here, she is sending her messenger to God, you see. To God like that, you see. Her hooded eagle into significance. Messengers of thought to the unknowable. What a phrase. Messengers of thought to the unknowable. Identified in soul vision and soul sense. Identified in soul vision and soul sense. Not only Atma Drishti and Atma Kriya Indriya, but the soul, that is the important thing, identified. He has identified his vision and his sense with her vision and her sense. Her stands for life. He stands for Ashwapati. So, Ashwapati has identified his vision and his sense with the vision and sense of life. It is because of that identification, he knows what she is, what plight she is, what condition she is, what she is here for. He has got now complete understanding of her working also. Now it is Samyama, identify in the Patanjala Yoga, it is called Samyama. So it is a kind of a Samyama, full identification of yourself with the object, then you get the knowledge of the object. By identifying yourself with the object, you get the knowledge of the object, you see. That is called Samyama. So if you do Samyama on the sun, concentrate, identify yourself on the sun, you get the knowledge of the elephant, of the universe. Patanjali says you identify all the locus, all the planes of consciousness, you start recognizing the entire universe, subtle universe, you start recognizing, you see. So identification Samyama, so by identifying yourself with the sun, you get the knowledge of the three worlds. By identifying yourself with the elephant, you get the knowledge of what the strength is. He gives certain examples like that, you see, of Samyama. So this is the kind of an identification. Ashwapati is identifying now himself with life, and therefore he has got the complete knowledge of life, her working, how she is moving all this. So if I want to really know you, I must identify myself with you. If I want to know him, I must identify myself with him completely. And vice versa, of course. Vice versa. So it is the identification. That is the unity. That is the real knowledge of the individual. Same way, what is an electron? If you want to know really what an electron, you identify yourself with electron, and the electron will reveal to you what I am. You have got a plant here, you identify yourself with that plant, and then the plant will tell you, look, look, I can do this, I can do this, I can do this. I am bhakti, I am devotion, I am prayer. You see, the plant starts telling you when you identify yourself. That is how the mother is telling you the various types of flowers and their significances, you see. She is identifying herself directly with the flowers, and the flowers are telling, yes, I am this, I am prayer, I am beauty, I am love. See, she is in surrender, she knows that, you see. You identify yourself with the mango, and you know it is the fruit of knowledge. Like that. So, this samyama is the key of the whole thing. Identified in soul vision and soul strength, entering into her depths as into a house. That is the identification. That is complete identification. You are not seeing from distance. You are really entering into the interior existence of the thing itself. Into her depths as into a house. All he became that she was or longed to be. Now, all he became that she was or longed to be. Now, this is a identification of life in the process of time. Trikala drishti of life. What she was, what she wants to be. He is trying to understand that thing. He is getting the dimensions of time. Life is here for. Life has come from somewhere. Life wants to do something. All that complete knowledge now he is going to get with this identification of life. Otherwise, how do you know what life is there? You see, it is not only this feature, that feature, black, white, green, crimson, red, this is not that. But the character, the dynamics of life, it is all that he is trying to get from that thing. All he became that she was or longed to be. He thought with her thoughts and journeyed with her steps. Well, the way journeyed, so that is the time process. He thought, with a thought, he thought, am, with a thought, and appear, and journeyed with, and journey, I am, eat with, prick, her steps, I am. So he got, I am, and appears, prick, sorry, I am, prick, I am. He thought, with a thought, and journeyed with a step, almost a mausoleum line is him, laid with her breath, and scanned all with her eyes. With her eyes, not with his now, that identification. See, the poet, the yogi is very particular about every detail. You want to know life, what life is trying to do and all that thing, you have to see through her eyes, through her working, you see, completely, you see. He lived with a breath and scanned all. That is the samyama, that is the real samyama. Absolute samyama with life or prana. When you do samyama with prana, then you get the knowledge of the working of prana, what the prana is trying to do. That he might learn the secret of her soul. What she is here for, what she is attempting to do, what she has achieved, where from she has come, he might get the full knowledge of that thing by complete samyama with prana, with life, you see. He might learn. Now he says again, might learn. Now identification is there, it will come. But then, does that identification mean that you get the definite knowledge? The poet is kind of cautious. He doesn't say that he will learn. He says he might learn. He's cautious. Why might? Because it depends upon the quality of our identification. If your identification is real, absolute, complete, perfect, then you will get that he might learn the secret of her soul. That is the important thing. That is the important thing. What you are going to do tomorrow, that I can know only if I identify with your soul. Then only I can perhaps know. Perhaps know also. A witness overmastered by his seen, a witness, that is Ashwapati himself, he is watching this game, these movements of life, therefore he is a witness, he is seeing that thing. A witness overmastered by his seen, He admired her splendid front of pomp and play, all those beautiful, lovely things she has done in the material world. He admired them, splendid front of pomp and play, and the marvels of her rich and delicate care. All little details which she is working here, he is admiring them. He is marveling how she has achieved all those things. See, it's really a marvel. Even, to create an ant or to create a human being is a real marvel of life. How she has managed to do all that kind of a thing. It's really a miracle. It's a wonder kind of a thing. You see, even a smallest thing. We hear. Ear is there, drum is there, and then something happens and it goes and then we interpret like that. But see the kind of details with which the engineering has been done in the physiology of our system. There is a drum, so it produces vibrations, sound, and then from the inner ear to the brain, there are two channels through which the message is sent. You see. Like this. And then the brain interprets, and then you understand what that hearing means. So that is a wonderful kind of an engineering. How she has done all that? Why she has provided for each ear? It's not the two channels, not that one channel failed, the other is there. It's not from the point of view of safety or redundancy that the two channels are there. The two channels are independently functional. They have their own. Some carry certain kind of vibrations, the other carry some other type of vibrations. There is a kind of a passage of different energies which flows through the two ears. So these kind of details with which the whole thing has been built by life is a real marvel. How it gets connected and all that thing, it's a marvel, everything. So in fact, if you go further back, we talk of five senses, Panchendriya, Mahabhuta, Pancha Mahabhuta. Sight, sound, taste, touch, fragrance, smell, all these things. Now, each one is built into our body and each one is carrying its message to the brain through all these things, you see. See, you think of food and your tongue starts watering. You think of food and the tongue starts watering. Is it also? Sometimes, you see, you think of something joyous, it starts feeling joyous also. Now, how that mechanism works, that is the engineering of life. She has really done that thing. She admired her splendid front and palm and marvels of a rich and delicate craft. That is the rich and delicate craft of life which has produced in the material world. Where there is no sensitivity at all. There is no sense at all. She has produced that sort of a thing, you see, in the material world. And thrilled to the insistence of her cry. And thrilled. He is thrilled. Yes, I am here to do, Impassioned, he bore the sorceries of her mind, the magic creations of her strength, of her work, he is bearing this. Felt laid on him an abrupt, mysterious will. In fact, he is kind of overpowered by her will now, that identification will be there. Her hand that need fade in the violent grasp. So she is manipulating fate also to get her own thing done. She is needing as well as manipulating fate to get what she wants to be done, you see. She has got that kind of a... So that is a magic, that is a craft, that is a sorcery of life in this material world. Her hand that needs fate in their violent grasp. Her touch that moves. Her powers that seize and drive. Well, that is the magic of her. This is the work of life. Now, this is the wonderful kind of a thing which life is giving. But these two, he saw. Now, that is a big but. Now, this but is preparing us all the problems of life. How life fell into inconscience and lost her power and charm. How Ashwapati sees life lying there low in inconscience. Like a hollow, you see, lying there in inconscience, you see. Like in a bush, a woman in a bush, as you see later on. But he saw her soul that wept within. Why her soul is weeping? Look, I have come all the way from the consciousness pose, from that high place. And what am I here for? What am I seeing here? I am not able to do all the royal things which are my native works up there. See. So she is weeping, she is feeling sad about it kind of way. But these two he saw, her soul that wept within. So now her soul is weeping within. Ashwapati is seeing, is able to see that soul weeping within. So that is the kind of an identification Ashwapati has with her, that he can enter within her soul and see what the soul is there, crying for what, he sees that thing. But these two, so that is a beautiful identification. But these two he saw, her soul that wept within, her seekings vain, that clutch at playing truth. Her seekings vain, that clutch at playing truth. She wants to catch the truth, but she is not able to catch it, hold it on. It is playing, it is escaping her sight. Her seekings vain, that clutch at playing truth. Her hopes, whose somber gaze makes with despair. She is weeping for that purpose. Her hopes, whose somber gaze mates with despair. The passion that possessed her, longing limb. That was the passion before she has come here, the longing limb. Even the physical, the nervous system had a longing here. The passion that possessed her, longing limb. The trouble and rapture of her yearning breast. She's seeing all that thing, the passion of her limb, the trouble and rapture of her breast. Her mind that toils, satisfied with its fruit. Her heart that captures not the one beloved. She is weeping for that. She is not able to capture her beloved. She is not able to remain with her beloved, you see, with the lover, you see. Ashwapati sees that thing. This is what happened, that she is kind of alienated from all the glorious things of which she is accustomed. Her hopes, whose somber gaze mates with despair. The passion of the limb, trouble and rapture of the brain, mind unsatisfied with its rewards, heart that captures one beloved. So he has given all the four aspects of our life, you see. Always he met a veil and seeking food. So in that identification, what is he? What does he see? That it is a veil and seeking food. It is a covered food. Seeking. She is in search of the value for which she has come here. She wants to establish them. Always he met a veil and seeking food. An exiled goddess building mimic heaven. She is of course an exiled goddess. She has been kind of driven out from her high place, high station, from the consciousness role. Sam Sachidananda, she has entered into matter. Therefore, she is an exiled goddess here, whose eyes look up to a hidden, an exiled goddess, building mimic heaven. She is doing some work here. She is producing wonderful things here, which she has described earlier. But they are all mimic heaven. They don't have that real content in them, what she has seen, she has in possession up there, you see. An exiled goddess, building mimic heaven, a sphinx whose eyes look up to a hidden sun. She is a sphinx because she is puzzled. She is mimicking. She is puzzled. She herself has become a kind of a riddle to herself. I was like that, and what I am seeing here is like this. How? It has become a kind of a puzzle for herself. Sphinx whose eyes look up, and therefore she is looking up at the sun, which might give her the true knowledge, true guidance, all that thing. As I told you last time, this sphinx occurs four times in Savitri. 52.23, that is what we got here. Then 78.24. Then 89.29. And then 109. 9.18 and a 9.18. 89.29. We got a completer description in that passage, 89.29. The vision, the vision and the boon, Canto 4 or Book 3. Let us read that, 89.29. Now this is the narrative. This is what the Divine Mother is telling to Ashwapati. Ashwapati is in a kind of haste to get certain things done, and she is cautioning Ashwapati, look, don't be in a haste, time will take care of everything. And she is giving the problems of hastening things, and in that context she is telling Ashwapati, an inner soul and a somnambulist force have made a world estranged from life and thought. Inner soul and somnambulist force, that is the lower being, Purusha and Prakriti in the lower world, Purusha and Prakriti in the lower world. Somnambulist force, she is a sleepwalker. And the inner soul, the being is there but not active. I made a world estranged from life and thought. Means she is saying that how the creation has started from down below and up to what point it has come here. The dragon of the dark foundation scheme, the dragon of the dark foundations keeps unalterable the law of chance and death. The dragon of the dark foundation is keeping the law of chance and death. Now this is a very, very clever kind of a description. You see, you can read in two ways. The dragon of the dark foundation keeps unalterable. The dragon of the dark keeps foundation unalterable. That is one way of looking and reading it, you see. But the other way is, the dragon of the dark foundations keeps. It is the dragon of the dark foundation who keeps. Not the foundation keeps, you see. Not the dragon of the dark, but the dark of the foundations he keeps. So it depends upon how you really read that line, you see. Means in other words, you should not have, so to say, a pause after dark. The dragon of the dark foundations keeps. Dark foundations keep. What? The law of chance and death unalterable. That is the dragon. And then he says, on his long way through time and circumstance, the grey-hued, riddling, neither shadow, spring, the dark spring down below. There is a dark spring below, there is a bright spring above. The springs of the inconscient and the springs of the superconscious, both of them are there. So he is talking of now, she is talking of the dark spring of the shadow. You drilling shadow spring, her dreadful pause upon the swallowing sand awaits him. With the soul-slaying word. So she is an Egyptian sphinx. She could be also a Greek sphinx or Thebes also. Across the passes, the dim camp of night. Now here he has described three things. She is describing rather three things. What? Dragon, sphinx and night. Dragon, sphinx and night. In the record of yoga, she opened the sphinx of four. Dragon, sphinx, night, and a rock. And rock, you see. So she has forgotten rock here. Rock, you see. She has forgotten. So basically, these are the problems of the creation from below she is describing. Shivananda has put that in a record of yoga. Sphinx, dragon, knight, and rock, you see. Now, it is this dragon and this sphinx who looks upon the riddle of this creation, the riddle of this world, whose eyes look upon the riddle of this world, the hidden. Now, I got some notes here. The dragon, etc. Now, sphinx, normally it is the head of a man or a woman. In Greek, it is a woman. In other places, it can be man head and the body of a lion. And the body of a lion. Head of a man, body of a lion. And in the Greek sphinx, she has got wings also. Wings, like an eagle wing. So, in the Greek wing, she is a woman with a head of a woman and body of a lion and eagle's wings to her seen. Now, sphinx stands for basically eternal quest. Eternal quest. Eternal quest. There is a dark sphinx of inconscience. There is also a bright sphinx of superconscience. It's a riddle to the mind. Now, obviously, according to the Greek mythology, a traveler who has to go on that in Thebes particularly, he has to go on that road. He meets a sphinx there, and then the sphinx will ask questions. If you are able to answer the questions correctly, she will allow you to go. Otherwise, she will swallow you up completely. So, it was only Odysseus, sorry, Oedipus. 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 He was able to answer her questions correctly. Yeah. Who is that who walks on 4 feet in the morning, two in the midday, three in the afternoon, and four later? He asked that thing. And he says, man, child, you walk on four, and then on two, and then you take the help of the third, three, and then so he answered her correctly, and then because he answered correctly, she killed herself. See, this riddle was solved. Man is the riddle. Man is the person now who is there, and now I don't have to be present there. So she vanishes completely. So that is the Greek mythology, Theban mythology. See. The sphinx whose eyes look up to hidden sun. Now this is the sphinx of the dark, and she is looking up at the higher sphinx, higher power there, which will bring light to her and tell her what to do, you see. So now this is what Ashwapati is seeing in his identification with the life force, with the prana. He has identified himself, and he says, now, so this is the story of that particular section. And now we are going to the next section, section 5. Section 5 has 34 sentences, 132 lines, and 1009 words. This is 132 lines. Actually, once you know the number of sentences, you can easily get the idea of the lines, multiplied by 4. And roughly that is the number of lines. So 34 sentences, 132 lines, and 1009 words. Words also you can get, roughly each line has about 7 words. 7 words, roughly. On average of Savitri. Of course, there are variations, but as a general rule. See. Now, so this is the new section now, which is starting. He's slowly preparing the other part. Why she is weeping, why she is crying, why she is in that miserable condition. So he wants to explore that sort of a thing. And this whole canto, this whole section is devoted to that sort of a thing. Eva, he felt near, a spirit in her form. She is there in this condition, But what does Ashwapati see because of his identification? He sees that even a spirit is present in her. Although she is fallen here, the spirit has not left her. She may not be fully aware of it. She may not be able to do what spirits want her to do. But then he sees that the spirit is still present with her. Ever he felt near a spirit in her form, the multiplicity of forms is present there. His passive presence was her nature's strength. Yes, of the spirits. Spirit is there, silent, quiet. But because of the spirit's presence, she is able to do these wonderful things there. That is her strength. The presence of the spirit with her is her strength. His passive presence was her nature's strength. The soul is real in apparent things. The soul, the spirit alone is real in apparent things, fleeing things, in changing things. This soul, this stands for the spirit. This soul is real in apparent things. Even upon earth, the spirit is life's key. Spirit is key everywhere. But even in the material condition, where there is falsehood and ignorance, even there, spirit is the key for all these things. But her solid outside, nowhere bear its tray. Her solid outside, life's solid outside, do not show the signs of the presence of that spirit. The spirit is there with her, but the way she is working, she is moving and all that thing, those signs are not available, visible to us. But her solid outside, nowhere bear its tray. Its stamp on her ash is undiscoverable. The spirit is working through her, but we are not able to discover how the spirit is working through her. How she is employed by the spirit, you see. His stamp, or the spirit's stamp on her acts is undiscoverable. In fact, that is her strength. Because the spirit is present, she is able to do all these miraculous things, these wonderful things. All the time. A pathos of lost highs is its appeal. Pathos of lost habits, that's the whole thing. She has come all the way from up there, and therefore there is a pathos, there is a sadness, there is a weeping, so to say. Is its appeal, or the spirit's appeal. Only sometimes has got a shadowy line that seems a hint of veiled reality. So sometimes you get a kind of a flash, and then you see that there is a kind of reality behind it, and that reality is taking you forward, you see. Only sometimes has got a shadowy line, a vague line, this indistinct line, so to say, that seems a hint of veiled reality. You know what, the spirit is working there. We are not able to discern it because we don't have that complete identification with her. But life herself also knows that the spirit is working in her, but she is not able to see the way the spirit is trying to get certain things through her. Life, that seems a hint of vague reality. Life stared at him with vague, confused outlines, offering a picture at him with Ashwapati. Because Ashwapati has identified himself completely with life, so the way she sees, he also sees that thing, you see. Life stared at him, vague, confused outline, offering a picture the eyes could not keep. Yes, a certain kind of a picture flows in front of you, but then it disappears completely. You're not able to grasp it, hold it on. Offering a picture the eyes could not keep. A story that was yet not written there. What is to be, what has to happen, that whole thing is there in the mind of the spirit. The mind, the spirit is there for a certain purpose, to achieve certain things, but that is not yet written there. The story has to be written out completely. Written out means things have to be worked out, have to be brought into expression. As in a fragmentary, half-lost design, life's meanings fled from the pursuing eye, obviously. As in a fragmentary, half-lost design. You have got a small kind of a design, you have some idea of it, but then the complete meaning of the design is not with you. Life is not able to see that thing. A fragmentary, half-lost design. Life's meanings fled from the pursuing eye of Ashwapati. Of Ashwapati, because he said, life's meanings fled from the pursuing. Ashwapati is pursuing, but he is not able to get that. Life's visage hides life's real self, Ram's side, life's secret sin is written within, above. Life's secret sin is written within, above. Who has written the secret sin? The spirit, within, above. So if you are able to identify yourself completely with life, if you are able to identify yourself completely with I, then you know what is written within and above. What is there within you, what is there in the cosmic dimensions, all that you will come to know, that you see. Life, secret sense is written within, above. Everywhere is there, but you are not able to decipher it, read it, because you don't have that kind of a faculty with you to read what is there in the book, in the scripture. The thought that gives its sense lives far beyond. It is inaccessible. The thought that gives its sense, that is not accessible to us. And therefore we can't read what is there in the scripture. What the life is here for, what purpose it is going to serve, why she is weeping, why she is able to do the thing, what the spirit wants to do, wants to achieve in her, that you cannot get. The thought that gives its sense lives far beyond. It is not seen in its half-finished design. Obviously. Because the process is on. Therefore, you can't see the meaning, the purpose for which the whole thing is there. Life has come to this point. She has produced something wonderful and all that sort of thing. Where there was no sense at all, when there was no feeling, there was no perception, she has done miracles. She has produced miracles, you see. But that is a half-finished design. There are still things to be got done far beyond what life has achieved so far, you see. Life has produced a man, but man is not the last being for her achievements. It has to go still further. Life as it is has to enter into life divine. She has to attain that life divine. Then the design is complete. Then the design is finished. The design is finished. It is not seen in its half-finished design. But when the design is finished, it does not mean that it is frozen. You have achieved something, all that, and you are happy and you are stuck with it. No, it is not that. The real dynamic starts from that point onward. The real dynamic starts from, once you have achieved that thing, then the real life begins. The real avenues open out for you. Until, it's not that you have achieved and you are happy, you are holding it on to that. It's not a frozen design at all. The design keeps on multiplying, changing colors, tunes, hues and all that thing, and keeps on producing wonderful things all the while, you see. So that is the new dynamics which will come out here. So the design is finished. It's not finished in that sense. It goes now into a different domain of action and representation. You see, the design, you see. You see, when you have gone to the transcendent, you have become immortal. It means that you have become frozen. You were stuck with what you had. You have become immortal. You are not able to bring out new dimension of the spirit into manifestation. And that can happen only when you have that sort of an immortality upon earth. Then the new dimensions of the spirit start opening out. And that is why you want immortality for that purpose. You see. You want that immortality for that deathlessness, you want for that purpose, so that new dimension the spirit starts expressing in you, in the manifestation here, in the creation here. It is not, so it's not a finished design in this sense. In vain we hope to read the baffling sign, that riddle, or find a word or the half-played charade. Again, see, this is the second occurrence of the word charade. We have already seen charade. The world language, you make signs and then you are supposed to guess that thing. So it's a half-played charade until now, you see. She is playing a charade with you. She is playing with you. We saw last time Silhouette. Silhouette was the French minister, no? In 1759. Silhouette, Monsieur Silhouette. Silhouette, you got a dark figure on a white background. This is Silhouette. A shadow is cast on his silhouette. Silhouette. He was a minister, French, I think he was a finance minister in the French government. Yeah, that's right, still good. So now he agrees, sorry, this is sin. Or find the word of the half-played charade. Only in that greater life, a cryptic thought is found, is hinted, some interpreting word. Interpreting word, it is a reference to charade. Charade, you interpret by word, you see. So, the poet is consistent about that thing. Some hinted, some interpreting word that makes the earth myth a tale intelligible. It does not remain a charade then. If you have got that interpreting word, then it does not become a charade at all, you see. Only when it is possible, when you can read that thing, when the charade is dismissed and you have got the full knowledge, when a greater life is found, only when a greater life is found, then it is possible, you see, that make the earth myth a tale intelligible. Something was seen at last that looked like truth. That looked like truth. Something was seen at last that looked like truth. What a lie. Something, Trotty, was seen, I am. At last, I am. That looked, I am. Like truth, I am. So the line starts with the Trotty and followed by 4 I am. Something was seen at last. See what a powerful that Trotty is, no? Something was seen. It's not something. It is something. Something was seen at last that looked like truth. In a half-lit air of hazardous mystery, half-lit air of hazardous mystery, that is what we got here in the law. The eye that looks at dark half of truth, the eye that looks at the dark half of truth, only the inconscient creation, that is what the eye looks at, made out an image, made a vivid blur, and peering through a mist of subtle tint, he saw a half-blind, chained divinity. He saw a half-blind, chained divinity, bewildered by the world in which he moved, yet conscious of some light prompting his soul. Made an image, made the vivid air. So in the dark he sees what? And peering through a mist of subtle tint, he sees through all that thing. What? He saw a half-blind chained divinity. Who is that chained divinity? Half-blind chained, who is that? This life. This life. This life. This life. She's a chained divinity here. So Ashwapati sees the condition of life. In fact, he is very strongly preparing your for the next canto, the descent into light. Chained divinity, you see. He saw a half-blind. Half-blind because she can't see the full thing. She has got beautiful things, she has got sorrow also. She is in touch with the spirit but can't see the spirit, you see that. Half-blind, chained divinity, bewildered by the world in which he moved, he, Ashwapati, yet conscious of some light prompting his soul, attracted to strange, far or shimmering, led by the floating of a distant player, attracted by the strange, far or shimmering, the hazy color, the moving light, led by the floating of a distant player, he sought his way amid life's laughter and call, and the index cure offered myriad steps towards some total deep infinitude. So Ashwapati is seeing the far end of life through all these things. Attractive, strange, far or shimmering, he is attracted by that. Led by the floating of a distant player, floating. Somebody is playing on the reed. Obviously, the Anandamaya Purusha, flute player, Krishna. Krishna, floating, Krishna. He is the Anandamaya Purusha. He is guiding you. The music of sweetness is there, telling you something there beyond. Led by the floating of a distant player. He is not visible, but he is there. He is calling you with his flute, you see, player. He is Anandamaya Purusha, playing on his flute on the reed. Led by the floating of a distant player. He sought his way amid life's laughter and call. By that call of the flute player, he is seeing, he is looking for laughter. and the index chaos of her mere yesterday. What the steps of life mean, he is trying to understand that towards some total deep infinitude, that all these things mean something definitely. He is trying to see that thing. Attracted to a strange power of shimmering, led by the floating of a distant player, led by the floating of a distant player. That is what Ashwapati is hearing, the sound of the flute, and that is leading him to that thing. Now, it is not just poetry that the flute player is there and the sound is there and being led. I believe this is also autobiographical. This is also autobiographical. Sri Aurobindo is listening to the sound of the flute player. The yogi is listening to the sound of the flute player among this chaos, among this confusion and all that thing. He is listening to the sound of the Krishna player. And it is Krishna who is guiding you everywhere. So this is, I would definitely say, absolutely autobiographical. That in the midst of this confusion and turmoil and tempest and toil and all that sort of a thing, he hears the sound of the flute player, the musician, Krishna playing, and telling him, look, 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 this is what it is meant for. You have to proceed further, you see. Led by the floating of a distant player. So, Ashwapati is really seeing the sense of life here, and life is being guided by some power, higher power. And that is what the flute player is telling Ashwapati, look, this is how you have to proceed, how you have to go, how you have to go. And exactly, perhaps, in the process of sadhana, possibly, Sri Aurobindo must have been at that particular stage. Yes, all these things there, the turmoil, confusion, conflict, everything is there. But then he also hears the sound of the flute player. Look, it is not all that. There is something deeper, something there. And he is kind of guided in his yoga sadhana by that flute player's sound completely. I would say this must be during the period, roughly between 1908 to 1912. Roughly, you see. Constantly. Actually, when he was in Alipur jail, it was Krishna who was guiding him. In the Alipur jail, he says, he had placed Gita in my hand in Alipur jail. And it is the yoga of the Gita he was practicing in Alipur jail. Now that cannot happen unless he has that contact with the player, foot player. He is coming and telling him, he is handing over the Gita to him, you see, like that. The message of the Gita is there. What is the message of the Gita? That life, what the life is going to lead further up, you see. This is distinctly autobiographical in my perception. He sought his way amid life's laughter and call and the index chaos of her period. So, led by the floating of a distant player, if it is so autobiographical, then again, I will hammer it out that the lives of Sri Aurobindo by our great friend say that there is nothing of any value as far as his biography is concerned in Savitri. He says Savitri is a fictional creation and you can't really get any data from Savitri about the life of the yogi. That is what he is saying, fictional creation, he says. But it cannot be anything more clear than this, led by the floating of a distant player. And he has already clearly said that in other places, you know, his association with Krishna and how he was led. He himself has said, he used to come and give me the guidance. And at one stage, he was told, in the Alipur jail case, it was going on, Sri Aurobindo was giving instructions to his lawyer, C.R. Das, Chittaranjan Das, this thing, that thing. There was a conversation. He was giving instructions to the lawyer. At one stage, he was told, you did not give any instructions further. You need not give any instructions further. He will do all that is necessary for you to be free. That was the assurance given by Krishna to Arjuna. So already the freedom was there, given Krishna had assured him that you will be released from jail and you will be free. You see. Already he had told him there, you see, in the jail itself, you see. Led by the floating, distant player, he sought his way amid lies, laughter and call, and the index chaos of her various obviously they look like chaos, towards some total deep infinitive, around crowded the forest of a sign. Forest of a sign, you see, there, of life here. At hazard, he read by arrow leaves of thought. At hazard, he read by arrow leaves of thought. So quickly, so swiftly, and to the point. Arrow leaf to the point, target of thought. That hit the mark by guess or luminous chance. You see, because it is a flute player who is giving you all that thing. The flute player is telling you now. So the arrow leaf is definitely going to tell what that thing is that hit the mark by guess or by luminous chance. It could be a chance, it could be a guess, but then behind that is the working of that flute player and telling him, yes, 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 this will happen. There is a hit mark. The target is hit completely. That hit the mark by guess or luminous chance. Her changing colored road lights of idea. Her changing, life is constantly changing her colors, you see, chameleon, road lights of idea, now this light, now that light, and you don't know how to walk, where to go, you see, the signals are constantly changing all the while, and the signals of uncertain, swift event, the hieroglyphs of a symbol pageantry, and a landmark in the tangled paths of time. What a description, you see, complete, you see. So, the road signals are there completely, every part of it is there. That hit the mark by guess or luminous chance. Her changing colored road lights of idea. And the signals of uncertain, swift event, they are constantly changing, but they have got a kind of direction also. The hieroglyph, the hidden sign, the glyph is not there, it's completely. Of a symbol pageantry and a landmark. In the tangled paths of time, in her mazes of approach and of retreat, to every side she draws him and repels. She is drawing, he is attracted because of that identification. To every side she draws him and repels, but drawn too near escapes from his embrace. Yes, she draws him closer, but then she at the same time escapes from his embrace completely. See. But drawn too near escapes from his embrace. Means he is not able to really hold on to her what she wants to do, you see. All way she leads him, but no way is sure. Absolutely, one must leave. Always spontaneous. She leads, I am him, but spirit. No way, I am, is sure. Again, I am. It starts with spontaneous. Always. She leads him, but no way is sure. Completely monosyllabic line, you see. Allured by the many-toned marvel of her chant, of her marvel, many-toned, the musical notes are rich in the vibrations, in the content, in the musical. Allured by the many-toned marvel of her chant, attracted by the witchcraft of her moods, and moved by the casual touch to joy and grief, he loses himself in her, but wins her not. She is very close to him, but she escapes his embrace. Life cannot be still seized by him, that is the condition. He loses himself in her, but wins her not. Fugitive paradise, smiling, fugitive fleeing paradise, which cannot be momentary, so to say, paradise, smiles at him from her eyes. Yes, in her eyes she sees paradise there, but it is fugitive, fleeing, cannot be seized and held on. He dreams of her beauty, made forever, forever he is. He dreams of her beauty, made forever he is. He dreams, I am, of her beau and appeal. He made, I am, for a, I am, I am. So, first foot is I am, second foot is Anapis, third foot is I am, fourth is I am. Forever he is. He dreams of his mastery her limbs will bear. He dreams the magic of her breast of peace. He dreams of her, but she is not able, he cannot hold her on to it, you see. Three types of dream. What is the dream? Beauty. Dream of beauty. Dream of mastery. Dream of bliss. Three dreams. But he is not able to hold on to them, you see. A pleasure to paradise. That is pleasure. The paradise is made of beauty, of mastery and bliss. But he is not able to hold on to that. It is fleeing. It is escaping, you see. A fugitive paradise smiles at him from her eyes. He dreams of her beauty made forever his. He dreams of his mind. See, these lines are symmetric. He dreams of her beauty. I am and a page. He dreams of his mastery. Here he is. I am and a page. Beauty of his mastery. Of her bell, dreams of her mad, all the first three fruit are I am an apostasy. He dreams of her beauty, mad, mastery, her. The other things are then varying, you see, the feet are varying. See, that is the beauty of Savitri also. See, it is not the same kind of a feet which is repeated in all the three places, because that will become monotonous. If the sound keeps on repeating that way, it will produce monotony. So here you got I am, in this line, you got I am. Then Anapes, her limbs again Anapes, shall bear. Magic of her breast of bliss, magic of the breast of her bliss. In her illumined script, her fanciful translation of God's pure original text. Fanciful translation of God's pure original text. She was sent by God to do some work. So she was given the script. And it is that script she is carrying here, but then it has become a fanciful thing here. In her illumined script, her fanciful translation of God's pure original text, he thinks to read the scripture wonderful. He wants to read the scripture wonderful. Hieratic key to unknown beatitude. By reading the scripture, he will attain that beatitude, that blissedness, that happiness completely. Hieratic. See completely. Holy scripture. He thinks to read the scripture wonderful. He thinks to read the scripture wonderful. Which is the scripture wonderful? The book which is given by God to life. He is reading that thing. Translating God, pure original text. That is scripture wonderful. For us, the scripture wonderful is Savitri. For us, the scripture wonderful is Savitri. But we can hardly read it. We can hardly enter into it, you see. We may keep on talking about it, but we can hardly read it, you see. He thinks to read the scripture wonderful. Hieratic key. So this line applies to all those people who boast about Savitri, that they know Savitri. Hieratic key to unknown beatitude, but word of life is hidden in this script. Actually, that is the point, that is the key. What is really hidden in Savitri, we don't have access to it. But the word of life is hidden in this script. The chant of life has lost its divine note. What a lyrical line. Yeah. The chant of life has lost its divine note. The chant I am, of life I am, has lost I am. Now, Shivendu pronounces divine, divine, not divine. He says that he uses the word divine as a trochee, divine. Not divine. So, you got the chant of life has lost its divine note. He reads divine as a trochee. Yeah. The chant of life has lost its divine note. That is what has happened here. Unseen, a captive in a house of sound. Because you chant, it is a house of sound, you see. The script lost its splendor in a dream of a dream, splendor of a dream. Listen to a thousand voice illusion soul. So what do you listen then? We only listen to the illusion's ode. Ode, a long narrative song, poem, you see, ode, you see. Listen to a thousand voice illusion. So naturally the truth may be the same, but illusion will produce thousand types of facets of it, you see. That's the power of illusion, you can say. Unseen, a captive in a house of sound, the spirit lost in the splendor of a dream. Listen to a thousand. So the spirit which is there here, what does he listen now from this life? The odes of illusion. The odes of illusion, the songs of illusion, that is what the spirit is listening there, who is there within her, you see. Unseen, a captive in a house of sound, he is there in her house, that's the spirit lost in the splendor of a dream. He is musing there, he is completely lost in life there, he is forgotten. But what does he listen? A thousand voice illusions own, a delicate weft of sorcery steals the heart, or a fiery magic tints her tones and hues, a vagrant march struck with the wanderer time. They call to a brief unsatisfied delight, or wallow in ravishments of mind and sense, but miss the luminous answer of the soul. That is a pity. Yes, because you are listening to disillusion's ode, so you really miss the luminous answer of the soul completely. So the spirit is there and is listening soon. A delicate weft of sorcery steals the heart. Yes, or a fiery magic tints her tones and hues, yet they but wake a thrill of transient grace. All these things, what life is producing are finally transient grace. You see, a vagrant march struck by the wanderer time. March struck, the march of music, notes of music are struck by the wanderer time. What time? Wanderer is the time. Now this, now that, constantly changing completely, one at a time. They call to a brief unsatisfied delight, or wallow in ravishments of mind and sense, but miss, yes, you enjoy mind and sense, but miss the soul, the answer to the soul. A blind heartthrob that reaches joy through tears. Heartthrob that reaches joy through tears. A yearning towards peace forever unreached, an ecstasy of unfulfilled desire, track the last heavenward climbing of her voice, her life's voice, you see. A blind heartthrob that reaches joy through tears, a yearning towards peace forever unreached, an ecstasy of unfulfilled desire, track the last heavenward climbing. Transmuted are past sufferings, memories. Past sufferings, memories that change into an old sadness, sweet escaping trail. So they have become and turned all her tears of gem to diamond pain. Solid, rigid, fixed pain, diamond is shining. They are all these things. Transmuted, that's the transmutation which has taken place. What is the transmutation? That her tears of gem are turned into diamond pain. Tears of gem are turned into diamond pain. That is the chemical transmutation which has taken place here, you see. Sufferings, memory, into an old sadness's sweet escaping dream, turned are her tears of gem, tears to gems of diamond pain. Her sorrow into a magic crown of song. So that is the sadness which is seeing here now. Brief are her snatches of felicity that touch the surface, then escape or die. The felicity touches the surface, it escapes or disappears or dies. A lost remembrance echoes in her depths. A deathless longing is hers, a vague self's call. A prisoner in a mortal's limiting world, the spirit wounded while life sobs in her breast, a cherished suffering is her deepest cry. I think we'll stop with that.
What a long description, and always she thinks of.
What a description.
A long description, and always she thinks of new aspects. This is amazing.
This is absolutely magical.
It's incredible. I mean, you think after the second and third and fourth aspect, it's over now. There's another one, and another one, and another one, and
yeah.
another one, and another one. It goes on and on.
Yeah. And now you see, and then the way the poet is describing, Sri Aurobindo is a great essayist. His architect of Savitri is wonderful. The whole section is now leading you towards the descent into night. Why life has suffered, how it has happened to it, and how systematically, how patiently. See the enormity or patience with which he is writing every detail.
Yeah, exactly.
Tremendous patience and tremendous perseverance, yeah. Tremendous labor also, you see.
And thinking about
you have got a picture, but to put it down like that, you need patience also, you see.
Yeah, absolutely.